Although elements from each culture may be assimilated into TCK's life experience, there's that funny word, assimilation, the sense of belonging is in relationship to others of similar background. By similar background, we mean similar experiences. So the traditional meaning of this term TCK, when it was coined in the 70s, it referred to foreign service kids, corporate brats, missionary kids, oil kids, military brats. And now it, the scope has grown. It also includes bi or multiracial children, bi or multicultural children, educational cross-cultural kids, meaning if you went to an international school overseas, children of borderlanders, domestic TCKs. Well, domestic TCKs also means like you didn't move because your parents kind of worked in the government or something. You just migrated. International adoptees, children of minorities, children of immigrants, children of refugees. So this definition is quite wide. Well, why am I talking about this? Well, a lot of TCKs, they don't always speak more than one language. Sometimes they just speak English and have their experience in, you know, said country. But a lot of us do speak more than one language. And the way that we speak it is a little bit different because it's, when you learn a language as a child, it becomes part of you. It's not like you've learned it as an adult where you have your dominant language, you've already established yourself, your identity as a person. When you're a child and you're growing up, these are still being established. They're still shifting. They're still moving. And when you're changing languages, you build relationships with those languages. And that affects how you see yourself. Well, a little bit about me before I get into the rest of it. I am half Mexican and half Mongolian. My mother is Mongolian. My father is Mexican. They met in Russia back when it was still the USSR. And I am the first generation mixed kid on both sides of the family. So that kind of adds to the mix. I grew up speaking Russian, Mongolian, Spanish, and English. Don't get excited, I don't speak Russian anymore. one of them had to go. I think I could only handle so much as a little girl. But I don't know what my second language or my third language was because I forgot Spanish at one point, and then I learned Mongolian, and then I forgot Mongolian, and then learned Spanish at some point. And somewhere along the lines, I managed to pick up both of them again. What I do know is that my fourth language was English, and it is the language that I now speak and manage the best. So we get into a funny little question then. What is my mother tongue? Is it the first language that I learned that I don't speak anymore? Or is it my mother's language? Because, you know, mother tongue, and I've spent most of my life hanging out with my mom. Or is it now English, even though it's not my first language, but it's the language that I speak the best? And then to add to all of this, this whole Mexican-Mongolian thing, I am half Latina, half Asian. I have lived in Mexico and I have spent some time in Mongolia. I've been able to see how Latin American culture is, you know, a certain way where there's this stereotype that we're more open, more loving, more, you know, more hot-blooded. and then you have, you know, that Asian stereotype that we're quite rigid, that we hide our feelings, or we don't, we're very high context culture, and English, and then American English, which is a whole other thing on its own. It's quite low context. You say exactly what you mean directly, you know. And what happens when we learn these different languages at a young age, and then we have like multi-ethnic and like your racial factors and people stereotypes about you all mixed into it? How do you figure yourself out? Growing up is already hard enough as it is. Let's add all of this into it. Don't get excited. This is the only meme I have for this presentation. If I could describe my life growing up, it's this meme right here. People would speak to me, and these are very vivid memories. People would speak to me, and I would pretend I knew what they were saying because the expectation was that I understood what they were saying. And I could reply yes or no, and then kind of act out my cultural ethnicity, perform it. It became a performance for me to put on a mask when I go hang out with, you know, not to paint everyone in a quite large brush, but if I was hanging out more with Asians, there's a certain behaviors I adopt and shift. If I'm hanging out with Latin Americans, one way or another, I'm much louder. And I become much more open with what I'm saying, just knowing what kind of responses I'm going to get from people. And I still kind of get strange looks if I use an expression incorrectly in that given language, or I don't necessarily, they can always pick up that I'm not quite from there, but I think I do a pretty decent job. But that was hard enough to come by, and now I'm a young adult, I'm able to do that. But growing up, this was my life, trying to figure it all out. So I want to talk about this word, because this word has a lot to do with my first resentment towards language. And this is where I get into kind of psychology and emotions of the third culture kid and how, for lack of a better term, messes us up a little bit. So before I get into the specifics of this word, I want to tell you guys a little story. So my mom, she's a Mongolian woman, and she studied in Moscow, which is where I was born, and she decided to go to Mexico to, you know, to work, raise me there, stuff like that. And she had to leave me with my grandparents, my Mexican grandparents, for a bit. And I was very attached to my grandparents, but obviously at that age, 4 or 5 years old, I was also very attached to my mother. And the weaning process is hard enough as it is. But I remember I went hysterical the day my mom had to leave me with my grandparents to go to the city. I went absolutely nuts, and I remember this day with so much clarity. And I understood a bit of Mongolian back then, but I suppose I spoke Spanish. But what I do remember about this day is that the more my mother said that she would be back, the crazier I went. I was like on the floor, just, you know, I went hysterical. And now that I think about that day, it makes me laugh, because the entire time my mom was saying, "Mama will be back soon, Mama will be back soon," I only understood Mom is going to take forever to come back. And that's because this word up here, otkhui, in Mongolian, means soon. But the only part of this word that I understood was the first part, not the suffix that negates the first part. I mean, I only understood the first part, and the suffix that negates that first part I did not understand. So otkh means sort of like to take a long time to linger, and gui is what you add to make it a negative. And all I understood was just that first part. But how is that possible? I was a kid. I understood Mongolian well enough. I just didn't know it well, that well. And this is a very common experience among TCKs, that we know and we can feel and we can speak in a language, but we still mess up. There are still things we don't quite get. We don't know it 100%. And when things like this happen in life, where it's very emotive, it's very charged, and you don't have time to, people just assume that you know what they're talking about, but you don't, and you get a certain reaction. What are the repercussions of that in the human mind? This question, all right. Well, what I will get into is third culture kids are notorious for not liking the question, "Where are you from?" And that is because we don't know how to answer that question. A lot of us will probably go, let me think, or we'll probably give you a BS answer, just like, "Oh yeah, I'm from here," without really getting to specifics. But one question that I think is very much neglected is the question of, for the multilingual TCKs, "Oh, what's your native language then? Oh, you speak so many languages, okay, so what's your native language?" And it's a innocent enough question, but for me, I still hesitated in the same way that I hesitated with the "Where are you from?" So I want to get into sort of linguistic nationalism now, because I think today, in this day and age, we live in a society where diversity is appreciated, more or less, you know? I mean, the fact this conference is happening is pretty amazing. But we also have to recognize that outside of this English-speaking bubble where we all intersect, there's still quite a bit of linguicism going on. There are still things, values, national values that we're trying to protect. You know, with good reason, of course. But then when you get TCKs that are kind of, you know, wallow in the middle, especially with the biracial and bicultural background, it falls on their lap to fulfill some duties that maybe is not their responsibility, or maybe it is. It's up for debate. So I kind of want to tell a little story about my friend. She is Chinese-Australian. She was raised in Australia most of her life. She speaks Chinese on a daily basis with her parents. She goes back to China every other year to visit her family. At work, she speaks quite a bit of Chinese with the Chinese customers. And she is, you know, a Chinese-Australian girl. But she tells me of a time that she went to the airport after visiting her family, and she asked the Chinese stewardess a question. And she asked something about her flight, and she asked it in English. And the Chinese, there were two Chinese stewardesses. The other one said to the other Chinese stewardess, "Don't answer her question, she's just pretending not to speak Chinese." And she said this in Chinese. Now the funny part about this is that if my friend did not understand Chinese, this comment would have gone right over her head. But because she did understand Chinese, it made her feel very uncomfortable and guilty for, hey, maybe I should have spoken Chinese. It made her very self-conscious. But it also made her angry, and she shot back in Chinese, "What does it matter to you what language I asked this question in?" Now, this doesn't happen at a large scale. It doesn't happen. It happens in our personal bubbles, these expectations that we place on others based on what country you're from, what your politics are. What are the repercussions, right? Well, something similar happened to me. And I love my country. I love Mongolia. It's like I'm actually long overdue for a visit now. But when I went back maybe 4 or 5 years ago, something very similar to what happened to my friend happened to me. Among my crowd, I am notoriously known for being half Mongolian, half Mexican. And when I went back for maybe a period of 5 or 6 months. And because I had grown up messing up, you know, my Mongolian slang and, you know, just being corrected all the time, I had it in my mind that I was going to go for 5 or 6 months and do my best to learn the new vocabulary, do my best to not code mix as well, because if I knew that somebody spoke English and, you know, I would sort of mix Spanish and Mongolian and like English and whatever and kind of get lazy with it, you know? But this time I was like, no, I'm not going to be lazy with it. I'm going to learn new words. And I did. I think I improved a lot. And even my friends back in the States who speak Mongolian were like, whoa, you actually just said that 98% Mongolian. We're really proud of you. And I was like, yay. Oh, I'm so proud of myself. And it goes back to just being proud of your ethnicity, being able to fulfill this part of your identity that language is a really big component of. But anyway, so let me tell you what happened. So I had done a really good job at speaking Mongolian every single day. I hadn't spoken Spanish in a long time, and I hadn't spoken English, so my tongue was sort of itching to speak English and Spanish as well, but I got rid of that by listening to some Spanish music. And there was no way I could find, you know, Latin Americans in Mongolia at the time, so, you know, I had to deal with that. But I could find English speakers. So I met a buddy of mine who was Mongolian, and he had studied in Australia for a few years. So he spoke English at quite a native level, and I was like so excited when we met. I was like, okay, we're going to speak. We just spoke English the rest of the evening, you know. While this conversation was happening, though, one of our elders passed us by, and he said, "Speak Mongolian," and then he just walked off. And I was just like, how rude, you know? I didn't know what to say, but I think the major discomfort that came with that was that both my friend and I knew that that was directed more at me than to him. And the reason we both knew that was because my friend was established as a Mongolian, as a full Mongolian, but this elder person that passed us by, he knew very well that I was half Mexican. So because of my racial background and the fact that I was speaking English rather at a native level, it didn't come as a benefit to me. It made me stick out like a sore thumb. And it placed this enormous responsibility to sort of, hey, you're kind of messing up our culture here, you know? And I guess looking back, it wasn't personal. It wasn't personal because there's a lot of things going on in Mongolia politically regarding identity. There's a lot of foreigners coming in now. There was, you know, that mining boom a while ago. a lot of people are nervous, and that's okay. You know, there's a lot of stuff going on there, and the way that they perceive me or people like me is for a reason. I've never really had an issue with going to Mexico and being perceived differently. But I have gotten the comment of like, aquí se habla español, in a really cutesy way, like, hey, we speak Spanish here, dear. I'm like, okay, I got it. Thank you for letting me know. To describe more in detail what I mean about this, I'm going to introduce my friend, one of my colleagues. I call everyone my friends. By the end of this talk, all of you guys are going to be my friends. So. I want to talk about my colleague, Christina. She is born in Argentina to Korean parents, and she speaks Spanish, English, and now she's living and studying in South Korea. And she has probably, her TCK documentary is probably one of the best out there because she gets really, really personal, and she discusses a lot of topics about language as well that I wanna show. Well, there's two parts of this video that I'm going to show. The first part is how Christina communicates with her mother in a mixture of Spanish, Korean, and English, which is very similar to how I speak to my mother, except it's not Korean, it's Mongolian, and it's not Argentinian Spanish, it's Mexican Spanish. The second part of this video that I'm going to show you is something to do with what I talked about regarding linguistic nationalism. I guess we can kind of hear that.
Hola.
Hola.
Yo soy la hija de Ana.
Yo soy Ana.
Thank you.
In our family, we speak Korean Spanish. All the complex words are spoken in Spanish, so that what you end up with is a very weird-looking conversation. Check it out.
Okay, so what you heard just there was just a mix of Korean, Spanish, and all this stuff. That's actually how I speak with my mother a lot of the time, except it's Mexican Spanish, because she did live in Mexico for quite a bit, so she speaks Spanish like a Mexican. That's my life right there. Up until I was 22 years old, I thought I was the only one that experienced this. And seeing this video just obviously did wonders for my heart. So that's the first part, and I wanted to sort of think about that bit. What does that say about cultural preservation? What does that say about language preservation? What is our responsibility as multilingual TCKs to learn our language really well, but also giving ourselves the room to mix it up, to be more authentically ourselves? The second part of this video is, I'm not gonna lie, it makes me very uncomfortable every single time I watch it because it hits me right somewhere really personal. But I want you guys to watch closely to what's happening here.
Hola, Juan.
Hola.
¿De dónde sos?
De Paraguay.
¿De Paraguay?
Sí.
¿Y identidad sería?
What? Identity?
Mm-hmm.
¿Sé?
No sé.
Confusing.
¿Por qué es confuso?
I don't know what I am.
So, like, elaborate on that.
It's like, I'm Korean, but I'm not. But I'm Korean, but I'm not. I don't know, it's like,
when you saw that clip of that guy saying like 한국말보다 스페인어를 더 잘하는 한국인이야. 너는 한국인이야. 말할 때 어떤 감정이 있었죠?
I got pissed at that guy. like, okay, ethnically, I am Korean, but I can't connect to Koreans because I don't emotionally feel like a Korean. It's like, I don't know how to explain this, but it's different.
I can't tell you how many times that has happened to me growing up. But for me, it was a bit different because you add the whole biracial thing into it. Then it's like, you have to pick us. Come on, you have to pick us. And I guess when you get older, I heard a few laughs in the audience when you guys saw that. It is funny. It's actually quite funny, and I laugh about it today. But when it's you on the other end of that finger, it's not very funny at all. It's just like anxiety ridden. And I guess the question becomes, at what point do you let your community negotiate your identity for you? At what point do you let politics of the country dictate who you are? And I guess it goes back to the point where I was talking about, you know, we do live in a very nice bubble right now where we do have the freedom to be and express ourselves how we want to, but there are cultures out there where you can't do that. It's not an individualistic society. It's still collectivist. You still have to suppress your certain things about yourself for the communal good. And that's part of the culture. And Korean culture, Japanese culture, Chinese culture, and even a little bit of Mongolian culture, I've learned that I do have to do that. My American desire to be this individual and express myself sometimes doesn't work in a place like that. And I think as TCKs or as cross-cultural individuals, we do have to learn when to do what. Oh, next. Well, in recent studies that measure multiculturalism and multilingualism and the personality profile of a TCK, some interesting observations, some interesting statistics popped up. TCKs scored higher on the dimension of open-mindedness and cultural empathy. Big surprise there. But they scored lower in emotional stability. Moreover, groups with multi-dominance in more than just their traditional dominant first language scored significantly higher on open-mindedness, marginally higher on cultural empathy, but significantly lower on emotional stability than participants with one dominant language. Now, isn't that interesting? Now, when I read this, I was like, I'm not emotionally unstable, come on. So we get stuck on the semantics there, of course, but what I do think this is saying is that because of situations like we just saw in that video, because of the politics, because of these stereotypes, because of, I mean, who likes to be told who they are, right? It makes TCK, especially the multilingual ones, because these comments don't go right over our head. We feel them. It makes us hypersensitive, hyper-aware, observant. And why is this with the TCK? Well, let's think about what migration really is. When we migrate from one place to another, what's going on with us as people? Well, it calls into question your already established personal identity. It calls into question your sense of self in the world that you've already, you know, established in your 15, 16, 17, 20 years of your life in one country, in one context, in one language. And this boundary between who you are, like your inner and outer reality begins to shift and change. How many of us have felt this way just being in a new country? Raise your hands. Yeah. Do you remember feeling nervous? Feeling like a child? You're just like, I don't know. It's quite a humbling experience, isn't it? But imagine having to do that several times when you're growing up. Several times. Because the migrant, they have this urgent need to absorb information, you know? It is the urgent need to pick things up so that you're at level with everyone else. And while all of this is going on, you're experiencing loss of your previous life, you're feeling dislocated, you're learning to manage cultural differences and where you fit into that. And all of this leads to actually continuous traumatic disorder, generalized anxiety disorder, panic disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder. And this is just with like migrants that move once or twice as adults. Imagine what happens with children, which is why I personally think that international schools, and even if you're moving around a lot, like it is really important to buffer a lot of these things with communication. You know, just this is basic stuff. Communicate, ask questions, you know, how are you feeling, what's going on. All of this is not because everybody's gonna develop mental health issues or anything like that. But and the term mental health is a funny one as well, because I'd prefer to look at it as the maintenance of mental wellness. We all have a right to do that. I want to get into cultural homelessness now, because when the previous things I just mentioned are not taken care of, there's something called cultural homelessness that begins to develop in the individual. And this is most prevalent in multilingual TCKs. Check this out. So the people who had high levels of cultural homelessness, they had lower self-esteem, and they were more likely to be biracial, multiracial. They had longer cross-cultural experiences at younger ages, and they spoke more languages and held more citizenships. And it's a lot of research has supported that adults who lead a cross-cultural mobile childhood and adolescence are at risk for cultural homelessness. And it's like, it's great, you know, you have so much privilege and you're like traveling and it's like, oh, what a dream, right? But that doesn't mean everything is perfect. There's still mental wellness maintenance to keep up with, and if not, it really takes a toll on emotional security and self-esteem. And I want to talk about this word, threat, because with the video that I just showed you, that little clip, the underlying subtext to a lot of these negotiations is that something's at the risk of disappearing, or you're a threat to our traditions or our culture or our language. There's a lot of things going on there, and both sides feel threatened. There's a lot of fear that's fueled by politics and stuff like that that is going on there, and and it's invisible, you don't see it. And when I was thinking about this talk and kind of preparing for it, I was wondering, what's at stake? Why does any of this even matter? You know, like, you know, just do you, do what you're supposed to do in society, follow the rules, play these roles, you know, and you'll be good. But it's not that simple. Like, what are the repercussions? What's at stake? And what I'm about to say, I don't mean to upset anyone. It might not be like the politically correct thing to say, but it is something that crossed my mind when I started seeing this on the news. In the recent years, we have seen religious extremism take on an American accent or a British accent. I'm not saying that there are no other factors contributing to this. I mean, there's a whole lot of things going on there that is not my expertise. But I do know about language, and I do know about how troubling it can be to manage your identities when you're growing up. So how does somebody that was raised in the West since childhood do something like that, you know? And there's something to consider there. There's something to think about. It may not be the only reason, of course. It's not what I'm saying at all. But it's worth thinking that we have to take care of people and how they feel. There need to be resources available, because we are becoming more diverse. We are interacting with each other more than ever. But that doesn't mean we understand each other better. There's a lot of interaction going on, but there's still a gap there, and we need to understand it before things get out of hand. So I want to talk about brokers. So what is our responsibility, not only as multilingual TCKs or cross-cultural individuals, but all of us here are polyglots? What is our sort of duty? Well, we are cultural brokers, first and foremost. Language is about empathy. It's about how we understand others and how others help us understand ourselves better, and vice versa. So, I guess the, that's fine. Getting to the end of it. Yeah, yeah. Now, we'll have time for questions. Kind of the point of this, I do want to interact with you guys. I'm not going to like talk all the way down to the end. it is, I do think that language is about empathy. I think that my personal experiences, what it taught me the most is that we all live in our context, our cultural context. It doesn't make one necessarily right or wrong. It's just a better way to understand somebody. And if anything, sometimes you understand somebody better in their own language or another language. You connect better with them. It's a bridge. And in one way or another, we're all cultural brokers. And a very, very important tool for this is language. Thank you.
Hi, thanks for your talk. My name is Christiane. I'm more or less a TCK as well. I'm French and German. I grew up in France, Germany, and Belgium. My mom was a TCK. She's French and German, grew up in South Africa and Singapore. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and my younger siblings, they moved with them to Dubai and to the Czech Republic. So the whole family is, you know. And I wonder what the impact of that is on relationships. Because like you said, when I'm in France, mm-hmm. I'm French, you know, went to French schools, it's fine. But they don't get the German side. It's just, you know. So you switch on part of yourself. And then you go to Germany, you switch on a different. Now I live in Switzerland. So, you know, whatever. And so my boyfriend now, he's an American Canadian who grew up in Israel. And I'm wondering, that can't be a coincidence. That it's TCKs who find out the TCKs who just get it, you know, with the languages and the passports. You know, like, oh shit, where's this passport again? Oops, which one should I show?
You know. Actually, this is a really interesting question because I've had a discussion about this on the internet, of course, on a TCK forum, and it's amazing the commonalities that come up because we're all from different backgrounds. We have different combinations of language and backgrounds and race and all this stuff, and a lot of our one of the topics that came up is that. How do relationships work with non-TCK people? Like people, if you're a TCK and you are in a relationship with someone that was raised in one country and only speaks one language, it does get very complicated. And there were talks of actually getting like a TCK dating site so that TCKs could meet other TCKs. And I don't know, I'm not necessarily for that, but it does, I do think it does get complicated. I guess for me, one of the things that I noticed is that in my own life, in my own relationships, is that people choose to see you however they want to see you, and what the TCK is best at doing is kind of being a chameleon. So we TCKs often fall into the trap of people pleasing, of sort of molding into this culture, and then. What they realize a few months down the road is that they're not being fully themselves because they're only being one third or one half or one quarter of who they really are, which complicates relationships quite a bit. But relationships are complicated anyway, right? Any other questions?
Hi. Well, I was born in Colombia, but I grew up in Spain.
Hola. So,
I really understand you, and the thing I wanted to say is that we speak the same language. So I speak Spanish, Colombian Spanish, and I have experienced that all my life, speaking the same language. I didn't actually know that I spoke differently to my mother. Mm-hmm. I discovered it because my mother called me one day, and my friends were with me. They were like, what are you doing? What do you mean? It's like, you don't speak like that to us. It's like, what do you mean? It took me time. I had no idea that I had a Colombian accent when I speak to my mother. So now for me it's really difficult when I meet somebody who asks where I'm from. I don't know what to say. Mm-hmm. So I'm Colombian, I'm Spanish, I have no idea. Mm-hmm. And then you have to start giving this long explanation. Mm-hmm. And people are not used to that. They are used to hearing I'm from there. Mm-hmm. Then, so yeah, it's quite, I really understand you, even if it's the same language.
Yeah. So. Something similar happened to me when I immigrated to the United States from Mexico. Porque mi español es muy mexicano. And it's very, very, very Mexican, and I'm quite proud of that. I'm like, yeah. But when I moved to Washington, D.C., there weren't many Mexicans. There were a lot of Salvadorians, Hondurans, and I started speaking Spanish in their rhythm. And I hadn't called my family in quite some time, and I called them, and I was like, ah, how's everyone doing? ¿Cómo están? I miss you guys. And all of a sudden, my auntie says to me, mi tía me dice, you don't even sound Mexican anymore. What accent is that? And I was maybe 12 years old. I was appalled. Oh, you guys don't understand it. It sounds funny, but after I got off the phone, I really felt like I lost a part of myself. Like I had let my family down, and it was like, and it, you, believe me, after that I started paying attention to my accent. Any other questions? Oh, this is great. I love interacting with you guys.
When I came in, you were talking about how you were perceived in the United States, and then you said sort of offhand, oh, well, it's different in Mexico. So I'm curious, how do they perceive your multi-ethnicity in Mexico as opposed to the way they do in the United States?
So in the United States, I kind of got off as an immigrant, or my friends just call me the Americanized one, and it's sort of, that was sort of a pass. In Mexico, it was a bit different because it's my blood, it's my last name, you know, my last name is Hernandez. And it was, I don't think it was good or bad, but it was always like, so why are your eyes like that? They used to call me La Chinita quite a bit. But the thing is, Mexico itself is quite diverse. You know, we have white Mexicans, European-looking Mexicans. We have Asian-looking Mexicans. And Mexico itself has gone through so much. You know, in Mexico we don't speak Mexican. We speak Spanish. That in and of itself talks about its history. The society has become its own thing through, you know, after the Spanish, you know, came over and everything. So I feel like in Mexican culture, there isn't that fear of like, oh, we're gonna lose something in any way, because it's already, Mexico itself already has a really long history of change. And there, I've always found that maybe it's the network that I sort of engaged in, maybe it was my family, but it was always very, very, very accepting, and I think that speaks to just Latins being really friendly.
Hi, that was a great talk. I'm not a TCK, but Japanese is one of my, it's my L2, and I'm constantly dealing with, like, oh my gosh, you don't look like you speak Japanese, which I don't know what that means, but I try very hard not to get passive aggressive about it. And I'm curious, how do you avoid being passive aggressive when you get that?
You asked I'm sure a really you get big it. Question. Actually, just today somebody spoke to me in Chinese. And it was really cute because I think, you know, they were trying to like impress me that they spoke Chinese, and I was like, how do I tell you that I'm not Chinese? You bring up an excellent point though. My answer to that is humor. Humor is the best medicine for everything. I've developed very passive aggressive tendencies, to be quite honest with you. So I do get when something doesn't, you know, rub me the right way, I'm like, I'm gonna let it pass, it's all right. But I've gotten better at just dealing with it with humor. It's funny. People were curious beings. So, hi.
I get the Chinese thing all the time too, and I'm not remotely Asian. And like in Toronto, people speak Chinese to me, and I'm like, sorry, like, nope. You were talking about our responsibility or commitment to like our cultures, and what do we do with all of this? Like, I myself, like, I was born in Venezuela, but I grew up in Canada, but my family's from Spain, and they speak Galician, and it's like,
wow.
One of the questions I always ask myself is, what effing language am I going to teach my future hypothetical children? Or how do I keep like my culture
yes.
alive, especially if I'm in a country that is not my own, and so I'm bringing these other cultures, but they have to learn the one here too. It's just like,
yes.
what do you think about that?
Ah, you bring up an excellent point. That is an excellent, excellent point. And I'm of the camp, and I may change, I don't have children, but if I do, I think my opinions may change, so don't take my word for it. But as it stands right now, the way that I look at it is that life is quite open-ended. So it's gonna depend on, I guess, first of all, who you end up with, what conversation you have with that person. Where you locate yourself, where are you gonna live? What is, at the end of the day, it becomes what's practical. You know, we learn language out of practicality. And then in the home, I suppose, you just have to make sacrifices and choose. I mean, a child can't learn five languages just because the parents, you know, amongst themselves speak five languages. That's borderline child abuse, I would say. But I'm sure the child could do it. But I do wonder about that with myself, because I'm very, very attached to Spanish. And I'm very, very attached to Mongolian. I don't speak either of them perfectly, to be honest with you, but I feel very, very attached to them. So if I don't know, if I get, say, married to an American and I have children, am I gonna teach my child Spanish and Mongolian because it's important to me, and then have that kid pick up that kid, you know, my kid, pick up English as well? Or what if, you know, my supposed husband that is non-existent right now speaks two languages as well? What do we do there? My answer to that is we don't know. We cross that bridge when we get there, and hopefully, you know, there's one language from each that sort of wins out. Yes?
I just wanted to say offhand that I have a friend in Canada, and he and his wife are bringing up their children in five languages, and it's complicated, and they do find a way to do it.
Really?
But you have to really, really want to. If you don't really,
yeah.
really want to, I mean, you have to really, really think of it. And I mean, if you're interested, I can, you know, give you his Facebook thing, because he's really interested in talking about it and does
that
demonstrations
sounds excellent.
And stuff.
Actually, I'll take you up on that. Mm-hmm. Actually, just one last thing. There are a lot of organizations sort of popping up that helps families in transition. There's a lot of things on the internet, forums coming up. And yeah, just Google. Anything else from anyone? Someone in the back? And the front, sorry. I'm really glad I left a lot of time for questions and answers.
Hi, I'm Rizal from Polyglot Indonesia. Actually, I have reverse TCK experience. When I was in Argentina, I went there for my high school. Nobody there believed that I'm not Argentinian, right? So they was like, you're lying, mentira, something like that, mentiroso, something like that. But they believe that I'm Argentinian, and when I say I'm not Argentinian, I'm here only for exchange student for 1 year, they don't believe me. So that's kind of like interesting, because I don't know if anybody has that kind of experience. But then I do have a lot of TCK friends in Indonesia, where ethnically they are Chinese descendant or like foreign descendants, but culturally they are Indonesian. I think that's kind of like the difference between ethnic and culture. Like, for instance, from the video, the Korean, ethnically
yeah.
they are Korean, but culturally he's not Korean.
Right.
They are culturally they are, he's from Paraguay, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good point. But my question is to you. Actually, do you think that the TCK that already reside in one country will lose their other identity? Do you feel like you, I think you are living in Australia for one, like I don't know how long, but do you think that you will be Australian and absorb the Australian culture and then lose the Mexican culture? Or, I don't know, do you still do the Mexican thing that's only, oh, that's kind of like really Mexican what you do, or I don't know. Because I kind of like when I come back to Indonesia from Argentina, I lose all of the Argentinian stuff. I stop, I've stopped moving my hands, on certain sentence, for instance. Okay. Well, I do now, but some sentence I kind of like not moving my hands, that kind of stuff.
Well, to answer the first part of the question is, well, I've lived in Melbourne now for 3 years, and there are certain things about my speech that has changed. That's not quite American anymore. What I've noticed Americans say at this point and Australians say at this stage. I can't do the accent. The first time I said mate was this year. there's a few things that I've picked up, but I don't think that. First of all, I don't think I'm ever, as of right now, I don't think I'll ever live in one place. Just stick around. I think I'll always be quite mobile. And while I'm doing that, I think I'll always be picking up stuff. But I think I'll also be losing a few things. But I think what's important to consider here is that once you get back to your environment, it doesn't take very long for you to, you know, jump right back into it. And I think that's the beautiful part about being multicultural or multilingual, is that you may kind of forget or, you know, not speak a language for some time, but you're around it, you know, for a week, or you have to speak it like a couple of days in a row, like you pick it back up. That's that. All right, cool. Thank you guys for your attention, and yeah.